glad she don't fuck with my sis. She comfortable.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to 1025 In Conversation. This is episode 10. I'm Jordan Walton, and today is a very, very special day as I am bringing on my childhood friend, Sean Kang. First off, Sean, thank you so much for being a part of In Conversation. And of course, we got something special for y'all today.
Thank you for having me.
Of course, of course. Now today, in celebration of a special someone, we have decided to go do a full-on retrospective on her entire discography. And who is that? The one and only Beyonce. Now, of course, Sean has the Renaissance shirt. Now, my introduction to Beyonce is a very weird one. I was introduced to her in the 2006 film Dreamgirls, and the song Listen was actually the first Beyonce song I ever heard, and I was like, oh my God, who is that? And it's been crazy ever since, right?
Yeah.
You know, she started off in Destiny's Child, then she went solo and became literally a global superstar. So today, in this episode of 1025 In Conversation, we're going to go through her entire discography, from Dangerously in Love all the way to her most recent offering, Renaissance, or Act One of Renaissance. Now, we are going to have a few exceptions. We are not going to be talking about her Destiny's Child stuff, mainly because we will be here all day. This would be a three-hour video, maybe. But we are going to include two projects that a lot of people don't really count, but they are Beyonce albums, and that is Everything is Love and The Gift. So overall, we're going to be talking about 9 Beyonce projects. So for everybody watching or listening, sit back, relax, and let's get this show on the roll. First off, we're going to talk about Dangerously in Love. This was her debut studio album, came out in 2003, and this is the thing, as you know, all the other Destiny's Child members, they release solo albums and all that stuff, but this is the one that really shot her up to superstardom. And this is the one that, while I have celebrated this woman and love all her albums, it's been a long time since I've actually sit down and listened to all of her projects from front to back. So Sean, I want to ask you, going into Dangerously in Love, what were your thoughts on it? And what were some of your favorite songs personally from this project?
So it was funny, like when I first heard Dangerously in Love, you can still very much hear her Destiny's Child influence. You know, at this time, I think 2003, I think that's when it came out. You know, she's fresh. She hasn't fully disassociated from Destiny's Child at that time, but you can still hear the influence. You can still hear the similar production. And Beyonce is still trying to find that solo voice of hers. And I think she did a good job. I think of it like 18 coming out of, you know, high school, I'm an adult, but I'm still finding myself. So when I go into the album, I kind of thought with that mindset. So when I heard the album, I was listening, I was like, okay, she's being kind of timid, but she's still trying to, you know, say, I'm gonna let you know that I'm my own person, and I'm listening. I would say my favorite songs, I hate when people ask me these questions, because anyone that knows me knows that I am a big Beyonce fan, and it's not that she can't do wrong in my eyes, it's just that she hasn't done wrong in my eyes.
Yeah.
So I would say my favorite album, if I had to pick one, like I said, they're all great, but as one of my good friends like to say, someone has to go under the other. I say my favorite one is Me, Myself, and I. Primarily because Crazy in Love got so much radio play, it kind of gets to the point, it's like, you know, I get a little annoyed of hearing it. Not that it's a bad song, it's that I'm annoyed. And, you know, I would say number two definitely is Baby Boy, primarily because my godparents are Caribbean, and I love, shout out to Sean Paul. I love anything that Sean Paul touches. And so with him and Beyonce, with their collaborated sound, the sound's beautiful. But, you know, I just feel like Crazy in Love is kind of like a go-to. Like, I obviously, everyone loves Crazy in Love, but I like to think of the songs that don't get the same radio play.
Yeah, see, it's very interesting you bring that up with Crazy in Love, because Crazy in Love was overly played, right? And one of the things that I thought about is, I've heard these songs so many times, Crazy in Love, Baby Boy, Me, Myself, and I, and all that, that in the context of this album, they kind of just come off as like, okay, these are, you know, not a blur, but they come off as like other moments off the album, more of the iconic moments off the album. My personal favorites, I gotta go with, and these are, I got a few. Naughty Girl, Perfect. Perfect.
Right.
A song, one song that I actually did not even know about was the song Hip Hop Star with her, Big Boy.
Yes. I think, Sleepy Brown. Yes.
I'm listening to this. I was listening to it for the first time a few weeks ago, and I was like, do I like this? Or like, what's going on? And then I woke up the next day and I just started humming the melody of Beyonce's part. I was like, oh, okay.
I like Hip Hop Star because also I'm also a big Outkast fan. So it felt like it was a Beyonce production, but it also felt like it was an Outkast production too.
Yeah. Yeah. Even the instrumental, like with that like electric guitar, it kind of reminded me of like the 90s Spider-Man theme song. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know why, it just
I can see that
just clicked in my head when I first heard it.
I think song that doesn't get enough due credit is her song with Missy Elliott, Signs. It's actually that song that taught me the zodiac signs in order. I like, because I just start going through some people like talk about, you know, what zodiac signs are. I literally start humming when she starts saying, you know, Capricorn, Aquarius, Pisces. And I'm like, okay, I think this month goes that month. Yeah. So it helped me.
Right. And then she started like describing them, like she was like sexy like a Scorpio. And I was like, yes, she knows. But Me, Myself, and I, of course, that's a great song. That taught me, from now on, I'm gonna be my own best friend.
Like, right.
Of course. Another song, this is one of her most underrated R&B cuts. I'll say Yes. That's a great song to me. Like,
said yes to you.
Yes. Speechless, Dangerously in Love.
Now, pretty good. Now, I rediscovered Speechless, like just listening to Beyonce on a regular with my friends. And then, you know, we had a good conversation about it. Like, we said Speechless crawled for Dance For You and Rocket to Walk and Run. I was like, I'll stick to that.
You're right. Yeah, you're right. But I think, now if there were, of course, I'm a Beyonce fan myself, but if there were some things that I would be like, I just feel like some of the songs, like, of course, Crazy in Love, I think all the singles were cool, but I don't think there's that extra like, that, you know, makes a Beyonce album from good to like, oh my God, great, basically. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And as far as like a score is concerned, just considering the fact that this was a solid debut, I gave it around like a 6.5 out of 10. It's not like, oh my God, it's not that I don't hate that project. It's just, there's not anything extra for me to be like, for me to chew on. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
The singles are great and the album cuts are good, but comparing this to her other work, it's like, okay, this is a cool, you know, debut, basically.
Absolutely. But, you know, it also, I think this is just with any artist, period, not just Beyonce in particular. So you got to give the labels kind of what they want.
Yeah.
For them to actually feel like they can put an investment into you. So, yes, this was her first individual project. Yes, people knew what she was somewhat capable of with Destiny's Child, but also at the same time, you have to juggle multiple voices with Destiny's Child. So Beyonce is trying to speak, give her voice, but also cater to, I guess, in a sense, what the industry wants. But I think as we, you know, obviously as we progress through the albums, we're going to see her establishing herself and breaking those barriers and topping herself off from her previous projects.
Yeah, and that's something that she did really throughout her entire career, which leads us into, I think, a great improvement over Destiny's Child, B-Day, which was, I believe it was released on her birthday in 2006. Yes. And, you know, this is the one, I think this was the first Beyonce album that I actually have heard my life, you know, when I started to get into Beyonce.
Right.
And I think this was a concise listen. And it also, it showed that, okay, this is the Beyonce that we're, you know, getting to know. And this is the Beyonce that's going to evolve into the global superstar that she is today. Now, a few standouts for me was Get Me Bodied, really good. Sugar Mama is my personal favorite off the project. I just love that, like, it has like that old school kind of instrumentation
with the production.
I think that's good. I personally believe Ring the Alarm, Walk, So Don't Hurt Yourself, Could Soar.
Oh, absolutely.
That's my personal opinion. Because when I hear Ring the Alarm, I'm like, this is so Don't Hurt Yourself. This is 1.0 of Don't Hurt Yourself, bro. Ring the Alarm. Freakum Dress, I think, is really good. I like Beyonce songs that feel like you about to get ready and go out to a party. Yeah. That's the type of Beyonce that I like personally.
She has a lot of those.
Yeah. Of course, Irreplaceable is iconic. Like, whoever, this is the thing. Everybody always wants to say, oh, who will Beyonce go up against in a versus? Whoever she's going to go up against, they're going to have to sit in front of Irreplaceable. Like, an iconic single, personally.
Yeah. I think that's one of her top singles off the album too. It's like, yeah. Like, cause I remember cause she had Irreplaceable, but then she has the Spanglish version. And I remember I watched one of her clips. I think she was performing, don't quote me, but I'm gonna say Barcelona. If it wasn't Barcelona, it was in Spain. I do know that for sure. And I remember, like, you can hear her like singing in between the Spanish and English version, and you hear them like replying the same version. So I think that just speaks to the reach that Irreplaceable has.
Yeah, Irreplaceable. To me, I'm gonna be honest. To me, that's a top five Beyonce song.
Top five? Okay. Are you ready for mine?
What's up? What is
so, it? So. I didn't listen to B-Day until the deluxe version came out. My number one will always be Beautiful Liar, her and Shakira. I remember I went up because, you know, back when DVDs were popular, I remember I was at one of my friends' house, we both went to grade school with, and they had the DVD of the Beyonce Experience. And so, I believe that was her first solo tour. So she did the dance of Beautiful Liar. And I was just like, it's so mesmerizing considering I've seen the music video. I was just like, dog, this is it. Like, and I always liked Shakira. Like, I like her music too. So like, it felt very like catering to the other like audiences, like ethnic audiences, but also keeping it true to Beyonce, which I thought was cool. She was keeping it very sexy and cool. So Beautiful Lies, number one for me. Number two is Sugar Mama. I really love Sugar Mama.
Especially
the verse where she's like, you can take my credit card, hit up my house, take my car. I was just like, I don't know about that, Beyonce, but I feel it.
I'm okay.
I was like, okay. You know, look. Mr. Man must have been putting it down. Hey. That's number two. Number three, I would say Deja Vu.
My brother loves Deja Vu.
Deja Vu is just so, because I think what gets me is that part when she's in the sand and she's doing the little dance.
She's doing all this.
Yeah. I like that.
I'm telling you, when I was younger, me and my brother, every time we spent the night over at our aunt's house, we always played Deja Vu from Beyonce. Like, literally.
But I also think when she's doing that dancing, it also kind of reminds me of Baby Boy, when she's dancing on the beach. Yeah. So Deja Vu is definitely number three. Number four, Resentment, because you always need a good In Your Feelings song.
Yes, Resentment is one of my favorites too, and she performs this all the time on the Run tour, right?
Yes.
And we'll get to that when we get to Lemonade.
Yes.
The backstory behind that, but
right. And then number five, I don't want to upset the girlies with this one, because number five, because Greenlight.
Greenlight is really fun.
Greenlight is a really fun song. I struggle with it, because if it's not Greenlight, I usually switch between Greenlight and Kitty Cat.
The music video where it's literally a minute long. Like,
yeah.
I remember like back in 2019, I was like, why didn't Beyonce ever finish that? Now, B-Day actually was a very important time, because this actually marked this isn't really the first visual album from her. Of course, self-titled is.
But B-Day was when she gave us music videos for most of her songs on
the album. She had the B-Day anthology video album, which was like a CD of just all the music videos. And this showed that she had potential as a visual artist too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I think B-Day was a B-Day, I think, is a solid. And Check On It. Check On It. That's my favorite too.
I do like Check On It. The Check On It is a great album. Now, is it in my top five for B-Day? I would put it in top 10.
Yeah.
I'll put it in top 10. It's just not my top five, personally.
Yeah. It's not in my top five either. It's like top 10. Me personally, it's like number 7, personally.
Yeah, it's 6 or 7. Yeah.
Number 7. And the ranking that I gave, the score that I gave it was about a 7 out of 10. I think this was a definite improvement from Dangerous Love. It was very concise, very focused, and it really didn't have any filler too. It didn't feel like some of these songs. It's like, okay, this one is cool. This one's cool. This one's great. This one's amazing.
Yeah.
It's very concise. And that's the great thing that I like about Beyonce's music is that she's very concise. She doesn't give these uber long projects. Very
concise. I think what's important to note about B-Day is this is when Beyonce and Jay-Z go public with their relationship. Like, they're dating at this point. Yeah. So it's like, you can see she's stepping into, I got this man behind me, you know, who's supporting me, who's a well-established artist on his own. Granted, Jay-Z's been out way longer than Beyonce. But obviously, she didn't want people to see her as like, I'm kind of just using him as a leverage into my career. Yeah. She was showing that she wants to show that she can be a heavy hitter just as, you know, just better as any other, any guy in the industry. And also, I think at the time, when Beyonce debuted, you had a lot of pop girls coming up at the same time. I remember there was one big thing, I forgot which was called, one critic said that they called her like kind of like another Ashanti. And I think she was trying to break that, I'm not another Ashanti. I'm Beyonce, I'm my own person, you know?
Yeah.
And I think B-Day definitely solidifies that.
Yeah, it definitely solidified that. And I just think this really showed like, This is the Beyonce that, you know, has elevated and began to become incredible. Okay. We just blew through her first two, but now we get to arguably her most divisive album among the fan base, right? A lot of people who talk to me, they either love this album or they really don't like this album. And that is I Am Sasha Fierce, released in 2008. Now, okay, this album, I was like, wow, I actually really like this project. And I do think that there is so much greatness on this project. There's so much greatness. Of course, this was a double album where the first half was I Am, so basically Beyonce. The second half was Sasha Fierce, persona that she created, right? In my personal opinion, I think the first half is the strongest of the overall project, personally. I knew this was gonna be a divisive one to tackle.
Yeah.
I just think personally, the overall like outdoorsiness, like before, you know, starting this podcast, I read up a little bit on I Am Sasha Fierce.
Right.
She wanted to dabble into more alternative kind of folk music for the first half. And then for the second half, that's where she goes into the electronica and all that stuff, the Euro pop stuff. I just think with the exceptions of personally, I want to say like Ave Maria and Smash You, those aren't bad, but they're just not the ones I'm going to listen to. I think side A is pretty good. Like, if I Were a Boy, great intro, a great opening. I think Halo is my all-time
favorite. Halo's one of the most popular songs too.
Halo is my all-time favorite Beyonce song, period. Yes. Like that
it's a great song.
That song just hits, right?
Right.
I think Disappear is pretty good. Brokenhearted Girl. I'm like, okay. Okay, yes. Good. Satellites, good. That's Why You're Beautiful. Good, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. So far, I'm like, okay. This is pretty good. And then, like, Satellites and That's Why You're Beautiful, to me, and I just wrote this, it feels like a Sunday afternoon, like, drive through the countryside. It feels warm. Like, the first half of this album feels so warm, right?
Yes. I see where you're going.
However, very controversial, I think the second half is where the album kind of loses a little bit of steam. Don't get me wrong. Single Ladies, incredible. Diva, yes. Great.
Great.
Sweet Dreams, great.
Amazing.
Hello, great, right?
Phenomenal.
But then we get Radio.
What's wrong with Radio?
Radio has this, I don't know, it's so like, it's like all over the place. It's like, okay, we got synth keys here, then we got 808s here, then we have like bass lines here, Beyonce doing this vocal inflection. It's like, wait, what's going on with this? I don't know. Maybe it's gonna grow on. I don't know.
I think with I Am Sasha Fierce, I think it is one of those albums where you have to, I'm the type of person, I like to listen to it from start to finish through and through. But sometimes you might need to go back and re-listen to it, and not necessarily just listen to a beat that you may or may not like. Listen to the lyrics. Understand what story she's trying to convey in those 2 to 3, sometimes 4 minutes, you know, of a song. Because it can actually be pretty poetic. Even if you may not relate to it, I think it's fascinating. I definitely see where you're coming from. I'm not shooting you down. I may not fully agree with you, but that is okay. Because I know at the end of the day, you are a Beyonce fan. I'm not about to chew your head off.
Beehives to beat me up. I've been a member since I was 6 years old.
So right, no, I'm not going to chew you up. I'm not going to chew you up. I promise. I'm not. But I'm not shitting either side. I think looking at both sides is the I Am side, I would say, is more like her vulnerability. She's trying to show her vulnerability.
Yeah.
And I think that was the whole thing with her creating Sasha Fierce, so she can pretend she doesn't have any vulnerabilities, that she's just that girl, and I'm just going to come deliver on the stage. I'm going to, you know, just blow it out the water every time.
Yeah.
I think that's what the Sasha Fierce side is trying to convey for the most part. And it's funny that it's ironic that you say that I Am side is here, because the Sasha Fierce side is my favorite.
And that's okay. That's okay. Right. You know what I'm saying? And don't get me wrong, there are moments on the Sasha Fierce side that I do think is great. Like I told you, Single Ladies, legit one of the most iconic music videos of the 2000s, period.
Yeah.
Point blank, period. I think, Ego. First of all, I had no business listening to Ego at 9 years old.
No, me knowing the lyrics was one thing. Me not understanding the meaning of the lyrics was another thing, especially in the Kanye West remix version. I was like, we ain't talking about an ego anymore.
I remember when I was younger, I played Ego one time, and my mom was like, turn this off!
And I know your mama too. I know that's exactly how she reacted.
I had no business listening to Ego at 9 years old. Zero. Yeah. None. Now, let me be honest. Do I think this is Beyonce's weakest album? No, I do not. Beyonce, to me, does not have a bad album, period.
Uh-huh.
Right? She does not have a bad album. I just think now, I think this album was a little bit too scattered, right? It's like, okay. One side we have folk songs, the other half we have Europop, and there are some singles for this era that did not make the cut. Like, for example, Why Don't You Love Me?
Yeah.
That is, I will never understand why nobody asked her, hey, Beyonce, instead of putting this on as a bonus track, actually put this as one of the songs on the project, personally.
But like I remember I mentioned before, it could have also been her label.
See, that's the thing.
It could have also been her label.
That's the thing. And we're going to get to, like, her kind of stepping into her own as a businesswoman when we get to 4. But overall, my personal rating, I do think that this is around, it's almost like the same score as Dangerously in Love. I'll give it maybe like a 6 out of 10. Not that it's bad, but just to me, I just think it was scattered. And I think the first half was the strongest. Now, you enjoyed the second half, and that is awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah.
I just think the first half, to me, was the strongest person.
Now, with that being said, if you had to pick your top three, including the bonus tracks,
okay,
I Am Sasha Fierce, list them. They don't have to be like, this is my number one, but just, you know, entertainment.
Okay, that's easy. Halo.
Okay.
Single Ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Hello. Okay, hello. Why Don't You Love Me?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm gonna just do 5.
Okay.
Why Don't You Love Me? And I'll do Sweet Dreams.
Okay. My number one, Diva.
Okay.
And I think Diva's my number one primarily because I've seen it live. And I love how she redoes it every time live. So yeah. Diva is number one. Number two is Why Don't You Love Me? Her On the Run rendition where she I think it was that On the Run Mr. Carter Show era was kind of in between when she does the call out to the audience and they do it back. I love when she does that. And Beyonce, if you are watching this, if you ever get a chance to watch this, bring back Why Don't You Love Me into your set list, please and thank you.
And please give us VIP passes so we can meet you, okay?
Because you know I can't afford the damn things. So Why Don't You Love Me, my number two. Number three, Hello. I do like Hello. Hello is a really good song. Because I love when she hits that octave when she has You Have Me At and she's hello. Because yes. I can't do it.
Yes, I but can't do it.
I was there with her. We were the same thing. That was what my number three. My number four. I don't really feel like a lot of people talk about it, but I actually liked it. I liked the Video Phone remix with Lady Gaga.
I like the remix with Lady Gaga more than the original one, personally.
I think Gaga adds a flair to it that just amps it up. And plus, 2008 era Gaga was a really, you know, because you had Poker Face, Telephone, era of Gaga, which was, you know, she was also an it girl for her time too. Yeah. So I think it just added to the greatness that Beyonce brought to the song already. And then number five, I'm gonna say Single Ladies.
Yeah. But yeah, overall, I mean, I Am Sasha Fierce. Don't get me wrong. I Am Sasha Fierce is a good album. It's a good album. I just feel like if one of us were on her, maybe on her label, we would have probably been like, okay, maybe put Why Don't You Love Me? But don't worry.
But then it goes into a question of which side, what Why Don't You Love Me go on?
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Hold up one second. Okay. Apparently it says we're running out of time, but that don't make sense because it's supposed to be an hour long, but whatever. If we run out of time, I'm just send you another Zoom link and then we'll just do more. Okay, so let's get to four. Now this album, I think this is when Beyonce went from good to great, personally.
Mm-hmm. Four was a that era was a lot for her because, you know, she had the inauguration.
Yeah.
For President Obama. You had, you know, her birth of her first child.
Blue Ivy.
It was a loaded era.
Yeah.
And the Super Bowl. I can't forget the Super Bowl.
Oh, yeah, Super Bowl. Right. Now, here's a fun fact. Beyonce actually submitted, I believe it was 72 songs to Columbia Records for consideration of this project.
Yeah.
And 12 of them appeared on the standard edition, you know.
Right.
So 12 of them appeared on standard edition. This was when she founded, I believe it was Parkwood Entertainment, mm-hmm. This was her company, and this is when she kind of severed her ties with her dad, who was her manager, Matthew Knowles. Mm-hmm. And to me, this is when I was like, okay, this is when she's evolving more. You know what I mean? Now, the one thing that a lot of people have mentioned is that this album leaked 2 weeks before its initial release date.
That's true.
And this is the reason why Beyonce did the surprise drop
when we for the self-titled. Yeah.
Another thing that, and I don't understand why the label did this, right? The album on all the streaming services, it has the expanded edition as the official mm-hmm. one. So basically, Love on Top is the opening.
Is number one, yep.
Yeah. And then, like, I Was Here is the closing. Now, I Was Here is the closing. But me personally, I think 1+1 is a superior opening to the project because it slowly brings you in to the album, in my opinion.
Yes. I agree. I think when you listen to the two different versions, it's like if you listen to the initial version first with 1+1 as number one,
yeah,
it sets a different tone versus if you had the expanded edition first, because Love on Top is so upbeat. So it's like, okay, you're coming into the album upbeat, whereas 1+1, you're not coming in like sad or anything. It's just it's like a slow incline.
Yeah.
Like a roller coaster, right? You like how on a roller coaster it goes up slow. And then it comes down fast.
And I
like that. Now, with the expanded edition, it kind of feels like it did a reverse.
Yeah, it felt like Beyonce just hit shuffle and then boom. Yes. Now we hit a completely different project. Now, a few of my personal favorites off the project. Party with Andre 3000. Great.
Yes.
I think the one with J. Cole was okay, but the one with Andre, I just think is great. It just reminds me of growing up in Stone Mountain. That's literally what it reminds me of. Nobody talks about this track a lot. School and Life, I think, is so cool.
Yes,
it's such a fun song.
It is. I think School and Life in particular kind of reminds you, no matter how old you can have fun and live your life, you know, be really whatever the hell you want to be. I feel like I don't think he gets enough love that it should. And usually when she does use it in her concerts, she uses it. It's usually just like an instrumental being played near the end of the concert.
Yeah, it's so 80s. Listening to that song, it just reminded me of like Ferris Bueller's Day Off, John Hughes type movie, and I love that. Another song, I Miss You, which was written by Frank Ocean.
Mm.
That is so good to me.
It's a good sad song.
Yeah.
It hits.
It hits. Dance For You is iconic, personally. Yeah. I Care. I think that's one of her best vocally songs, Beyonce.
Absolutely.
Oh, let's see. The track Rather Die Young, I'm listening to it and I'm like, okay, I get it. Beyonce saying, hey, look, I'd rather die young, whatever, be with you. And I'm like, okay, Beyonce, you know.
It's, you, I think it's a good song. Like,
yeah,
it's an underrated song.
It really is. It's really.
And nice. Because I think one of those, that's one of those songs on the album where she really challenged herself vocally.
Yeah,
because if you go back and listen, it's like she's hitting different octaves rather rapidly, and it's like, girl, if it was that was me, my voice would have went out.
Exactly.
So, but I think personally, now my favorite song off of 4, and no one talks about it but it's so good and the message is so meaningful. It's Start Over.
That's one of my favorites too. Start Over. That's
because like favorites. I like the message at least I take away from Start Over is, okay, let's say, like, I'm putting in a scenario. Let's say you're in a tumultuous relationship where it's like you kind of lost that spark. Start Over is like, let's go back to our first date. Let's find what made us fall in love in the first place, and let's see if we can salvage that love and give this love another life, you know.
Yeah.
And I Start Over just, oh, it does it for me every time, because it's like, I think Start Over is really good to listen to after I Miss You.
Yeah.
I really do. Yeah. I think it pulls you out of your feelings to like, okay, I'm going to recenter myself. I'm going to try this shit again. And I'm going to give it my all once more.
Yeah. Let's see. 1+1, like I've mentioned, that is such a great. That, to me, that is a better opening to the project. Me personally, like you mentioned, a roller coaster. End of Time is so good. It's just, I love the drums in that song. And I love this like warbling voice.
Yeah.
Boom, boom, boom. I love that.
I think my favorite performance of End of Time is either her Revel performance in Atlantic City or the Super Bowl performance, because I love that stomp she does at the beginning.
Yeah,
and then where she like slaps her leg. It's like, whoa, it's like,
yes,
you're like bold. Hey. I was like, I know your legs was burning after that performance.
I know. I know. And then now I actually think I Was Here is a really good closing to the album. Yeah. It basically is her saying, I want to leave my mark
on Mark, people, absolutely.
You know, when she leaves this earth, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I just think, like, the hearts that I've touched and all that, and I'm like, yeah, I mean, Beyonce, if you watching this, the two of us have been touched by your music. Like,
no, literally.
Incredible.
And I think because I've seen her perform it, like, you know, for Chime for Change and stuff like that, I think it's a phenomenal song, and it has such a powerful meaning within itself, because you don't, when you leave this world, whether you're famous or not, you would ideally have a legacy left behind, whether that's children, whether that's a charity, that's about whatever it is you think your legacy should be. I think it's, you know, just, you don't want the world to forget who you were. And, you know, I think it's a powerful message, especially looking back on the music celebrities that we lost. Like Whitney Houston, Michael Jackson, Whitney Houston. Yeah, yes, it was a Dolly Parton song, but we're always going to know Whitney Houston for I Will Always Love You. Michael Jackson, I mean, hell, his whole entire career from Jackson 5 to his solo career, we're going to always remember, at least our generation will. I think this newer generation needs to be like familiarized with their songs. But like, you know, I think, I mean, especially around Halloween time, everyone and their auntie at every store plays Thriller.
Of course.
You're going to know Michael's voice off of I Always Feel Like Somebody's Watching Me.
Yeah.
So, you know, because, you know, Thriller was his song or his legacy. I Will Always Love You, Whitney's legacy. That's my point. Yeah. I Was Here just kind of speaks to that testament. What do you want your legacy to be? And I think it's a good message and a good question to pose.
Yeah, of course. Of course. And overall, I think this was the beginning of Beyonce stepping into her own and becoming not just a great singer, but a great artist too.
Absolutely.
And overall, I give 4 an 8.5 out of 10. I think this is another great improvement from her previous work. And this was the beginning of her critical acclaim, personally.
Okay. I can agree with 8.5.
All right.
I can rock with that.
Okay. So I gave 4 an 8.5 out of 10. Now let's talk about my personal favorite Beyonce record.
Okay.
This was the album that, to me, I was like, oh yeah, this is my one. And that is Self-Titled. I remember the day this came out, everybody in school ran up to me and was like, Jordan, Beyonce just released another album. And I was like, yo, for real? So I remember I ran home, my brother was already playing it. Because this, remember, this was before iTunes came out. I mean, no, hold up. This was before Apple Music came out.
Right.
So you had to get it on iTunes, right? So the surprise drop, something that really changed music, to be honest. It was so innovative and just speaks to her influence. And it also was her first official visual album that was released on iTunes and YouTube. It was every song had a music video to it. And just the opening line of the album is, what is your aspiration in life? And then Beyonce says, to be happy.
Be happy.
And following that, we just get a fun, just experimental, vibrant era.
Yeah.
What about you, man? What are your thoughts on Self-Titled?
I always liked Beyonce, but I think Self-Titled is what officially made me a fan. Like, I was like able to faithfully say, yes, I'm a fan of Beyonce. And like you mentioned, Self-Titled broke a lot of barriers. It, first of all, no one was really doing surprise albums in the first place. Beyonce broke iTunes, like literally, like from so many literally people purchasing broke that it. Shit. And then she set the industry standard for dropping albums on a Friday. And I vividly remember I was in middle school. I think I was in sixth grade and my mom dropped me off. And my friends were talking. And then I got a little ping because I think it was like she was one of those artists I follow. And it was just like, Beyonce has a new album. And I was like, oh. So I think I went on YouTube and I watched the videos like with my friends. We're all sitting there gathered around watching it on my little ass phone, on my little Samsung Galaxy S3. And I'm watching the videos and I'm like, wow, she really pushed the envelope with this album. Mind you, I'm in the sixth grade. I still didn't need to be listening to self-titled the way I was listening to self-titled. Cause it was a Beyonce we had not heard. Like, if you think about Dangerously in Love to 4, she was playing Innocent Girl into young adulthood. I feel like self-titled plays into grown woman sexy. Like, I know who I am. I'm a mother, but I'm still gonna be sexy. I'm still gonna be this firm, independent woman. And, you know, to speak for women of all backgrounds of, you know, whether you're single, whether you're taken, whether you're a mother, whether you're not, you know, you feel like you can be in a space where you can be sexy or not, you know? And I got a lot of flack as a kid. It was like, you know, you like Beyonce, why don't you listen to these rappers? I was like, I don't want to listen to these rappers. I don't listen to Beyonce.
Exactly.
Turn the Beyonce off right now.
Right. A rundown of my personal favorite. It's literally this whole project, except for like three songs. Ooh. Everything else from top to bottom is just, oh my God, great. Pretty Hurts. Phenomenal. Phenomenal opening. Haunted. This was like, okay, Pretty Hurts. It was like, okay, this is traditional Beyonce song. Okay. Then we get this dark, ominous, it feels like a haunted house-esque type of theme. Yeah. I was like, whoa, okay, great. Blow, I think, is really good. I think it's a little too long, but Blow is so good, personally. Mm-hmm. No Angel, I thought originally, I think
No Angel is one of her most underrated songs off of self-titled.
It is.
I think it is.
And when she comes in with that falsetto, I was like, a part of me was like, do I really like this? But then over time, I started trying to do it my damn self.
I'm trying to force my voice to sound hoarse and shit. This is just a meeting. I was like, I can't do this, but it's so good.
Good. Partition. Great. Jealous.
And before you continue, I would love to point out how she did a music video for both parts of Haunted and Partition, where you get like Ghost, and then you get Haunted, and then you get Beyonce, and then you get Partition. Because I'm watching the music videos before I actually like go and just listen to the album on its own. So I'm looking at the album, I'm like, where is Ghost? Where is Beyonce? Even just on the track list itself. So when I go and listen, I'm like, oh, she put it all in one song.
Yeah, wow. She just combined it.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, Partition just reminds me of like 2014. I think this album came out when I was in like seventh grade or something. Mm-hmm. And it just brought me back to that time period. Jealous, I think, is so good too. Jealous, I will say, is like the precursor to Lemonade in a way. I kind of view it as that.
I see where you're coming from.
Okay, how about this? I view Resentment and Jealous as the precursors.
I can see where you're coming from. Yes.
Became Lemonade. That is a good one. At the time, mine was my favorite song off that project.
I know how much you like Drake.
When I tell you, see, at the time in 2013, 2014, I did not know I needed a Beyonce and Drake collab. Yeah. And then we get Mine, right? We get both of them harmonizing in one. We get Beyonce talking about, you know, she hasn't been felt like herself since giving birth. And is this relationship between her and Jay gonna even work out? And then we get Drake doing typical Drakiness. And then we get, and then it's like, okay, you think the album's about to, I mean, you think the song's about to end. It's like, okay, that was such a great, good song. And then it transitions, and in Drake's second verse, I was like, love this song. I love Mine, bro. Mine is, and that made me realize, like, I really need another Beyonce and Drake collaboration.
Yeah.
I need another one, bro.
I think they do a really good job with that collaboration, because if, you know, for people of our age, we remember Drake first as a singer before he was a rapper. To see him kind of go back, when I first heard him, I thought it was just going to be a solo, like just a straight R&B collab, like no rap included. So to hear Drake's, you know, come back to that melody, I was just like, okay, this is nice. I haven't really heard this Drake since, you know, like Take Care era, or maybe even what's it called, Thank Me Later era. So when that first switching and Drake pulled out that rapper, I was like,
I'm not gonna lie, I was listening to that before I started this and I was like, yeah, this is fire, this is fire.
And then I think of riding down the street late at night, like when I think of Drake's first, like I'm driving late at night down all these damn abandoned streets, and I'm just like, where am I about to go? I'm about to go see this girl, even though I ain't supposed to be at her house at any time of night, but here I am.
And then, you know, Mine is great. And then EXO.
Yeah.
God, I love that song. Like, EXO, and the music video just fits. Like, in this music video, Beyonce.
It's so fun.
Yeah, yes, that's the whole vibe of this album. It's fun. It's colorful. It's vibrant. You know, her and her friends, they went to Coney Island.
Yeah.
And they just had fun. They had a fun day. It's like me. This song makes me want to take a bunch of my friends and just go to Six Flags for a day.
That's right. I think what's funny is I like looking at the testimonials. So like, you know, the people who, like, you know, the crowd that was around them during EXO, that was like a genuine crowd. Like people were like genuinely surprised that Beyonce was there. And people were confused because they were like, because like when they talked, like when the new people talked to them, they were like, so what was going on? And Beyonce, they're like, well, it looked like Beyonce was lip syncing something. Like, maybe it was for a song, because you just genuinely didn't know what she was doing. Because she was just, they said she was just walking around, just mouthing shit. And I was like,
that's literally the thing. And I remember I think it was at the premiere of the visual album, she basically said the exact same thing that you said, Sean. She had an earbud in her head, and she was walking around Coney Island with the director, you know, cameraman, and she was just mouthing like, and I was just. And that's another thing. She filmed majority of these videos in secret. Not a lot of people knew. Like, even Jealous, they just saw Beyonce walking down the street. They didn't know, like, wait, what? And so when you see the reaction, that's a genuine reaction.
When she bumped into the guy, she did it on purpose, but he wasn't, like, a paid actor. It was, she just bumped into a guy on the street. And honestly, respect to him, because anyone that just shoved me out in the middle of nowhere, I would have been looking at you like, bruh, what are you doing? Like,
excuse me. And then you got that shot where Beyonce, it looks like she was crying, her eyes are all red, and she's just looking. Bro, if that was me, I probably would have had a heart attack. Just, oh my God.
Yeah.
And then, like, the second collaboration between her and Frank Ocean, Superpower, I think is really good too.
Super underrated too.
Super underrated. I kind of view this album like a dream in a way. So for example, in the beginning of the album, when the announcer says, Miss Third Ward, what is your aspiration in life? These are, and then in Haunted or Ghost in the music video, it looks like Beyonce's like in limbo in a way. And we're in these other songs, we're seeing like moments from her past, basically. And I think Superpower is when she fully wakes up from this dream, basically, that she's
I like what you're saying. Like, I definitely see the vision.
Basically.
And maybe that is what she intended.
That,
who knows?
That's kind of what I got. I was thinking to myself, wait a minute, Beyonce is probably in limbo, and then these are moments from her life, right? And so far, the whole project, I'm like, okay, this is fun. All right, this is cool. And then we get Heaven. I'm kind of embarrassed to say this. This is the first Beyonce song to make me cry. I'm not going to lie.
Heaven is a tearjerker, for real.
And you know what's crazy? I heard this song the first time 3 years ago. I was like, oh, Heaven, I don't think I've heard that song before.
Yeah.
Listen to it, broke down crying, right?
Yeah.
And then when I came to revisit this album again, I was like, should I skip Heaven? But then again, Heaven is such a beautiful song. And I'm like, should I skip it? And I played it. And I'm not going to lie, I felt a tear coming. I was like, no, please.
Yeah, I think with Heaven, as it relates to the whole, like, entirety of self-titled, it definitely has to be one of those songs you have to, like, really be in the mood to listen to. Like, can you do you have the emotional capacity to really listen to it right then and there when you listen to self-titled? Because yes. it's just because the tone just shifts so dramatically, and not in a bad way, or it doesn't feel like forced way. It just, you know, it's like you're listening to like mellow, like getting hyped to like, okay, I'm not about to make your ass like basically cry me a river for real. And so it's like, can you really bear to listen to that at the moment? Not in a bad way. It's just it's like, am I like, it's basically, do I feel like crying today? I don't think I'm gonna cry today. But then you put on heaven, you're like, oh, I'm about to cry today.
Yeah, I literally felt it, like I felt the tears kind of about to touch my eyes, and I was like, oh my God, please don't tell me I'm about to cry. Please don't tell me. And it's crazy because that's like the power of music. It doesn't matter how long you've heard that song, it just hits you, and but it's a beautiful song. And even in the music videos, when the shots of her about to cry, I'm like, oh shit. Like there are moments where
she's doing like the little prayer beads.
And then the closing, my personal favorite, Blue, I just think I think that was a perfect.
Hold on, because you missed a song.
I missed a song. What song did I miss?
Flawless.
Flawless is one of those songs. It's one of the three songs I just think is okay, but I don't think it's anything crazy. Now, I will say, the remix she did with Nicki Minaj, I actually think is fire, but just. Like, okay, when I listen to self-titled, I'm not really going to be listening for Flawless. Flawless is great. Don't get me wrong. Flawless is great. But I'm going to be listening to Partition. I'm going to be listening to Jealous. I'm going to be listening to Blue. Like, Blue, to me, the reason why I love that song is that it's just, it feels so warm. Like, if Heaven beat you down crying, Blue is the song where it kind of picks you up, dust all the dirt off you, wipe your tears, hold your hand, and walks you home, basically.
Okay.
That's what it felt like to me. Like, it feels like a Studio Ghibli movie. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Like some My Neighbor Totoro type stuff.
Yeah.
Not saying I don't like Flawless, and not even saying I don't like Drunken Love. I just think social media.
You sure? Yeah, I definitely didn't. I missed that you skipped Drunken Love. I didn't peep that initially.
I feel like Vine overplayed that song so much. And even Rocket is really good. I think Rocket is a little too long, but it's still a good song. Very Dangerously in Love influence, but it's still a good song. This whole album from track 1 to track 14, I think is great. And you know, Beyonce did do that little More Only EP where she had like 7-Eleven, Standing on the Sun. Those are good songs too. But in the context of this album, I think the album just it's a good cap off at Blue, personally.
Okay.
What about you?
Okay. Now, before I give my intake, you are restricted to three and three only. Pick your three songs. Don't have to be in order.
From self-titled.
Yeah.
From self-titled. Okay. Blue.
Blue.
I'm gonna go with EXO.
Okay.
And while I like mine, while I love mine, I think.
I see you struggling with this one too.
Hold up. Blue, EXO. I would have to go with, for my third one, maybe Partition.
Okay. There. That's a solid mix. Now, before
I hear wants to put mine in it, but nah.
I see. I see. Now, before I get into my take, I think when I think of Heaven into Blue, when I think of Heaven, the first thing I think of, considering I watched that, it's like a little documentary she put on YouTube. I think it's called The Year
Life is But a Dream.
Not Life is But a Dream, but I think it was involved with that. It was
Year of Four was during the, it was during the Four era.
Right. But like that and Life is But a Dream, I'm bringing this up for a reason, because I know she talks about her miscarriage. And I feel like that's what Heaven was, more of an ode to her unborn child that she lost.
Yeah.
Then I feel like Blue is kind of like, the even though I lost that child and I loved it, even though I didn't get to meet it, I have a wonderful one in front of me. I'm going to love her to the best of my ability as a mother and as a woman. And that's what I think of that. A lot of similar points about self-titled that you made. Great album. Changed the game phenomenally. I don't agree with anything that you said about well, not anything, everything. I don't agree with a lot of things you said about Flawless. I really like Flawless. Now, for the girlies that got into Beyonce later on, like the OG fans will not know that the first part of Flawless, Bow Down, was its own song. Yes. It was Bow a down, song. It was mixed with
Go.
I'm sorry. A lot of
My fault.
No, you're good. So like a lot of the new girls don't know that Bow Down was mixed with a song called I've Been On, which she would be solo as a solo song on Homecoming, but they were one song on her. That's like the only song she actually released on her SoundCloud. for the 10 minutes Beyonce was on SoundCloud. That's the only song we got to hear, because I remember she played it. I think it was a Super Bowl commercial, but she was dressed up in the whole regal Victorian era attire, and you got to hear it playing in the background. But I like Flawless because I used to listen to a little bit of Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie on my own, so like just to hear her voice is so very soothing. But I just like how raw Flawless is, and I think Bow Down adding to it was very, it just added to the rawness of it, and maybe because the visuals also add to that rawness too, because it was very grungy, like basement party type shit, where like I'm graffiti all the fucking walls, and I'm about to do for the rest of my friends. And that's why I like Flawless. Drunk in Love, I think it was a very fun album. It took me back to I Am Sasha Fierce. It did. If I were to put that on I Am Sasha Fierce, it would obviously be on the Sasha Fierce side. But I think overall it was very amazing production, especially when you see like the names attached to it, like Sia, Pharrell, Jay-Z, of course, The Dream, you know, all phenomenal writers and artists within their own right. And then also I remember watching the little clips she posted of the making of Self-Titled, which I think added another layer, like making me think some things. But if I had to pick my top three in no particular order, Haunted definitely is on that list. Partition is most definitely on that list. But number three, I've been struggling with that one for a minute because I went back and re-listened to it, and it's such a great album. No Angel.
Okay. I respect that. I 100% respect that. Now, my
Blow is like number four for sure. Like,
yeah.
Because it's a fun number.
It is. And the fact that she shot the music video at a skating rink just makes sense. Now, I personally rank Self-Titled a 9.5 out of 10. I think it was a fun, experimental album. It left her extremely hopeful for the future. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And I just think it was that whole project, I just think it's so good, man.
Right. I agree. Now, I'm not taking away from anything. I think I would just personally put it at a solid 9.
Okay.
And the reason I say that is because, like, personally, I feel like every time Beyonce just tops herself off. So, as I mentioned before, so I put it at a 9 just so I can give room for the other albums to put them higher.
Oh yeah. And then next in 2016 we get her magnum opus. We get at the time her magnum opus, Lemonade.
I still think it's fair to call it that for now.
Yeah. This was the response to the Jay-Z cheating allegations. This was right after, I believe it was the Super Bowl performance where she was clad in the Black Panther get up, performed with Bruno Mars, Coldplay. And I think this was like the first time Formation actually
was performed live. Because literally the day before she dropped the song.
Yeah. And then the visual album, it debuted on HBO for a one night only. It was a one night only thing.
And I recorded that thing and watched it 10, 20 hundred times.
You are so lucky because I personally had to, I bought the physical album.
I bought it too. Now,
and the DVD of the whole film is there. I think this album is fantastic. Yeah. I think listening to it, and I remember back in 2019 I watched the visual album again because it was on like Vimeo or something. Mm-hmm. I watched it again and I was like, this is so good. And it made me realize if Beyonce wants to retire and start directing films, I would not bat an eye to that, because I think this was so, it was like an art house film. It was like some Terrence Malick type shit. But yeah, I mean,
it felt like something you'd see like from an indie artist, like indie director. It was I mean, all music is art, but I think Lemonade's visuals were definitely a work of art, because not to say that I think it did a better, like a more linear, concise storytelling than Self-Titled did.
Yeah.
Because it was like because obviously each song led into the next, and I think also what added to it was the commentary she added for each song.
Yeah. You know, Self-Titled was more of non-linear short films that were kind of stitched together mm-hmm. in a form of a story. Lemonade was a full-on narrative about it was a narrative about a woman who experienced the infidelity of her lover, and we see these vignettes of her, of the actions that she does until she comes back and reconciles with her. A few of my personal favorites really is damn near this whole project. Pray You Catch Me starts the album on a quiet note, and then it's slow progression,
kind of like what we talked about before with 1+1.
The track Don't Hurt Yourself, I'm thinking to myself, do I really need a Beyonce rock album? Because the fact that she sampled Led Zeppelin and then her distorted voice, her screaming, her, like, this was the first time I ever heard Beyonce like genuinely pissed off, basically. Like, that's
absolutely.
It felt
now. So now, here is an unpopular opinion of mine, and I may get a lot of flack for it, but I will stand 10 toes down on it. What's up? Forward is not my favorite song.
Forward is okay. I agree with you. It's just a James Blake interlude, really.
I guess maybe because I'm not a James Blake fan, it just doesn't sit well with me. Not to take away from the artist, I don't think any artist is genuinely bad if they've actually put the work in. And I know James Blake is one of those type of artists. It's just because I don't listen to James Blake on a regular. Like, it's more so if I'm at a friend's house and that's what they like, and they just happen to play it, it's just playing in the background. But I think it just didn't do it for me on this album in particular. Now what song that does it for me every time? Love Drop.
That's so good. It gives off, it kind of reminds me of FKA Twigs a little bit.
I can see that.
Like, it has that ethereal vibe. Now, a track for me personally that gets me, Six Inch. The Weeknd.
Like it.
Imagine someone comes up to me and pitch me this idea. Jordan, you're gonna have a song with Beyonce and The Weeknd over a dark, brooding Isaac Hayes sampled beat. Yes. And this is one of those songs where I kind of made my own like music video treatment for it, where, because you know, the original video is good. Her in this like red, like duotone look. But here's my take, right? If Beyonce came to me in 2016, I was still in high school, but if she came to me and said, Jordan, what's your idea for Six Inch, right? It'll be like this. Okay, Beyonce is in this house, right? She's one of these dancers in this house. And the house is the House of Balloons. And who is the owner of this, like, let's say it's a mansion. Who's the owner and who's sitting in a chair watching her the weekend? You know what I mean? Because, you know, House of Balloons, that was his thing.
Yeah.
I dug it.
I see the vision. Now, here is what my take would be for Six Inch. And I think it's partially influenced because of the things I've watched most recently. So picture it. The music's playing and it's like a guy walking in, like it looks like a strip club. Primarily think P-Valley. If anyone's ever watched P-Valley, think Pink, right? But you're pulling up, you know you're not supposed to be there, but you walk in and then you just got women all in, you know, doing their thing, doing their dancing. And you're kind of like startled. And it's like, it's just like red, just like a lot of red lights. It's very dark, like you barely see even your own like hand, but you see the lights on these women and they're dancing, they're doing the thing. So it's like, you know, because you know the lyric goes, you know, she walks in the club like nobody's business. And so it's like you see Beyonce at the end of the hallway, and she kind of looking like the mistress, like the madam, I'm the head of this thing. And she's approaching this person, and kind of invokes this sense of fear, like what is about to happen to me. Because when I think of Six Inch, it kind of feels like a sequel to Haunted. That's the haunted part. It feels like a sequel to me. And I think part of that is because of the visual, she's walking out of the house and it's burning down behind her. Very horror-esque.
Which is such a great visual. That is such a great visual.
And then if you think about it, it is a testament to the cheating. It's also a double entendre of her metaphorical, house and white picket fence burning down around her. House, her family is in turmoil. It's actually a very powerful message when you sit and think about the art behind it.
Six Inch. That's my personal favorite off this project. Daddy Lessons, that's a really good song. I like the country influence of it. Sandcastles to me is one of her best ballads.
It reminds me of Heaven with the tear jerking.
I don't think it's as heartbreaking as Heaven, but it's definitely just painful to listen to.
It is painful.
In a good way. Yeah. You weren't the biggest fan of Forward. I think Forward is just a good kind of like transition into Freedom with Kendrick, which I think is so great. I think that was a collab
I didn't know I needed.
Yes. Yes.
So I really liked it. I think their styles merge very well together. Because it, and if you think about it, we heard Formation first, but I'm talking chronologically on the album. I would say Freedom is her first Black Power song. Cause she had that string of Black Power songs there in 2020. Yeah. So I would say Freedom and Formation would probably tie for like her first Black Power song.
Freedom is great. I think All Night is a good cap to the story of Lemonade. I think that's a good ending to the story because Formation, if we're viewing this in the context of a film, Formation is basically the song that plays when the credits roll in a movie. You know what I mean? And I think Formation is a good song too. I mean, that was like the second like Black Lives Matter type of song, even the visuals. Where you have the little boy breakdancing in front of the police. I mean, that was another great one. That was another great visual. Now, and here's actually an unpopular opinion, because I actually heard this album on Spotify. I prefer the original demo of Sorry more than the actual song. Sorry is a great song, but like the original
I don't think either versions are bad. I just think they have two different emotions that they're trying to evoke, Sorry, it's kind of like I kind of think Irreplaceable, like the original version that we hear. I think Irreplaceable meets Freakum Dress. That's what that feels like. Now the demo version, Sorry, it kind of feels like a resentment.
I think it's
two different feelings.
Yeah, and it also has that because I think Solange is featured on it too. It's basically both of them saying, yo, we could really be out here living like young, wild, free. We could actually be out of here. And it's kind of peaceful when you hear it. And I think that being like the official closing song of the album, it kind of ends it off on a quiet note too, a little bit. Like, Pray You Catch Me, it starts it off on a quiet note, and then we get this extravagant event, and then it just ends off on a quiet note. Now, I'm gonna ask you, since you've asked me, if you were to pick your top five songs from Lemonade, what would you pick?
Formation, Love Drought, Six Inch, Don't Hurt Yourself.
Don't Hurt Yourself, okay.
Freedom.
Mine's personally, and that's phenomenal. Mine's personally, Don't Hurt Yourself, Six Inch, I'll say All Night, Freedom, and Sandcastles.
Okay.
And the overall ranking for that, I give it a 9 out of 10. I give it a 9 out of 10. I give it her. It's her most ambitious and mature album. Yes. I think her best album, period. But and not every album has to have replay value. But I think certain songs, it's like, okay, I'm going to Six Inch. I'm going to Don't Hurt.
That's so fair.
But overall, I just think it was a great project. And the visual album, it just enhances the experience the same way that self-titled did.
Mm-hmm. I think also what enhances the Lemonade era is you have to think about also how her live performances went, like her and Kendrick's BET performance was a really powerful performance. Also funny because she was also A, in the middle of touring, and B, that was like the first time in a really long time you've seen Beyonce at the BET Awards, because she doesn't really go to BET Awards anymore. I think it was ever since that that thing when her album up against Watch the Throne. I think that was the last time we saw at the BET Awards. But then like just the Formation World Tour in itself was just such an amazing tour. And you had, and plus also you got to think in the context of when it came out, this was during Trump versus Hillary. So you even had her doing political performances.
Oh yeah.
Cause she performed, I believe for Hillary, like I believe it was she did Formation for Hillary's campaign.
Yep. Yeah, man. I mean, Lemonade really made me respect Beyonce as not just a singer, as a visual artist and an activist too.
Yes.
As an activist. Okay, now we have 6 minutes left. Of course, when this runs out, I'll send you the next one. And then we'll
do it again. Yeah. Hold on. What about the gift? And
we're gonna be talking about it. We're gonna talk about it. Okay. We are gonna go through two projects that I'm not gonna lie, I was a little skeptical in doing. Everything is Love and then The Gift. Let's talk about Everything is Love first. I was a little skeptical about this because when it comes to Beyonce and Jay-Z collabs, don't get me wrong, they are great, but sometimes it's like, okay, they kind of talk about the same subject matter.
I have
more money to burn in front of you. I'm married to the baddest chick in the game, which is true.
Which is true.
we have money to buy anything. Haters can hate and all that. So going into this album, I was a little bit skeptical and I was like, okay, Summer, that's a good song. Ape Shit, I think was overplayed, really. It was basically-
I think overplayed, but I think it's good. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, overplayed. And I was like, okay, Boss, I think is really good.
Yeah.
Aside from those first three songs, I love this whole record. Okay. From Nice all the way to Love Happy, I'm like, this is actually really good.
Yeah.
This is really good.
I think, well, it's funny, I was actually vividly remember where I was, where Everything is Love, because I remember the video for Ape Shit dropped, and I was like, okay, this is dope. And I was like, you know, I'm thinking it's one of their, because you know, this is during that time when they were just dropping, like, they would either pop up on like a lot of DJ Khaled singles, because they did Shining, and Top Off. And so I was like, okay, I thought this was just them doing like another like single and calling it a day. And I remember when I went on Instagram, because I know they were already on the Run 2 tour. And I have a friend who lives in Europe and went to one of the Europe performances. And it was the performance where after they finished the concert, the thing went on the banner saying, I'm out now. So I'm like,
yeah.
So I'm like, I'm typing on the computer, like, okay, Beyonce, Jay-Z album. Cause like, what's funny is cause the Beehive, someone in the Beehive will always know something. And for years they had been talking about a joint Beyonce and Jay-Z album. I just never thought I thought it was just like BS. And then when it finally happened, I was like, oh, so I already had that Spotify premium. I was like, let me go ahead and listen to this. Right. I'm gonna listen to this. And I liked Summer. I think Summer was good considering when they released the album. It feels very like chilling, either chilling on the beach or chilling in the pool. Like just it's like on a chill day. Oh, I really like listening to that. Ape Shit. Despite it being overplayed, which I agree, it's definitely overplayed, but also granted, you have two artists who are very highly respected in the game. So yeah, they're going to play that pretty often. I still think it was great. I also like the imagery because I've always wanted to go to the Louvre. So it was kind of like taking kind of a personal tour to the Louvre for me. Yeah. Boss, I think it was cool because you never really hear Beyonce talk about being a boss. And not in the sense of being, you know, a woman who's independent and strong. It's just, you never hear her talk about being a boss because she is literally a boss of Park. She runs Parkwood. And she has her Ivy Park line. She is literally a boss. And Jay-Z, I mean, hell, if anyone can talk about being a boss, he owns his own record label, his management label. He owns a little bit of everything. you know, so I think that's, I think it was kind of a polite way of telling you, showing us more so how to be a boss as well.
Oh,
because I remember there was a line in Boss where Jay was like if you a boss but your team ain't a boss, then you ain't a boss. And I thought that's it was like, if you're gonna come up, you bring people up with you. And I think that's a very powerful message. The whole album was great. I think one of my besides those three, I think one of my favorite was 713. I think that's one of my favorite Beyonce Jay-Z songs. But there's song. So there's a song that not a lot of people know exists, because if you don't have title, you wouldn't know it exists. And it's a song called Salute. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good one too.
And it's so good.
Yes. Oh my God. Yeah. This album really surprised me. Like, a rundown of my favorites. Nice. 713. Friends. I actually really like Friends. I like Friends. I think overall in this whole project, I think Beyonce was the standout on this project. Like, yes. I think she was the most melodic, had the most energy. She was kind of...
I mean, but also naturally so, because that's more up her alleyway than Jay. Jay can give you a good little verse, but obviously you ain't looking to him to give you a harmony.
Yeah, yeah. Friends is really good. Heard About Us is actually my personal favorite off this project. Just the laid-back vibe to it. Black Effect is really good, and Love Happy to me is a good conclusion. I view Love Happy as like the conclusion of the Lemonade 444
Absolutely.
Saga. You know what I mean? Beyonce saying like, "Yeah, I'm still kind of butthurt what you getting," and Jay's like, "Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, okay.
Let's move. Let's get over that and just move on." You know what I mean?
But I also feel like Love Happy is like, it reminds me of those songs at the end of those movies where they tell you where the cat, like the, where the characters are, like, you know, years later. It gives me those vibes.
Yeah. And just overall, I give Everything Is Love, I think, a 7.5. Aside from like the first three songs, which I just thought were okay, I think it was a concise and very focused album and a focused conclusion to the whole infidelity saga, basically.
Yes. I'd give it an 8 only because I wish we got more visuals.
Yeah. I wish there were more visuals to this project. Okay. So now we are going to talk about the compilation album that she did for the Lion King, the most recent Lion King movie back in 2019, called The Gift. Now, one of the things that I was a little bit skeptical about going into this project is that I'm not the biggest fan of like Afro beats in a dance hall personally.
Okay.
Not that I don't like that sound. I just think that it's okay. It's okay, right? Even when Drake did it on like Views and More Life, I wasn't the biggest fan of either, right? So going into this project, I was like, okay, I heard Bigger and Spirit, and I thought those were really great songs. Bigger is a great opening, Spirit is a great closing conclusion.
Yes.
And then we get, oh, and I forgot, the visual album slash film for this, Black is King, that was released on Disney Plus, which that just that actually made me enjoy this project a lot more personally,
right?
Because overall, I just thought this project was just okay. You know, just by itself, you know.
That's fair.
Yeah. Just real quick, a few of my personal favorites, Find Your Way Back and the Mellow X remix, which is on Spotify.
Really? You like the remix? It wasn't bad.
The remix is okay. It's okay. Not great, but it's just
still sorry.
Yeah, the original song is way better to me. Unpopular opinion, Nile is actually my favorite track off of this.
So
What's up?
When I think about Nile, it feels so incomplete to me. It kind of reminds me of Birthday Cake on Rihanna's Talk Their Talk album. I was like, okay, where's the rest of it?
Yeah. Now, Beyonce has explained that. And it was one of the documentaries for The Gift. She basically said, it's supposed to represent that, like, in that limbo feeling that when you pass away, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, I'm like, why? Okay. And a lot of people came up to me and like, Jordan, why do you like Nile? It's so incomplete. I just love the serene nature of it. Like, it feels like
it is definitely serene for sure.
Yes. It feels like you're in a lake and you're just, or you're like on the beach and your body is just floating on water. I just love it. Mood Forever is another one, another Beyonce and Jay-Z collab where I'm like, okay, this is good. Childish Gambino kind of sounded like Drake on the song, just his vocal ability. And I was like, it's still a good song. I still think that's a good song. I think the best song off this project is Brown Skin Girl. I think that is such a beautiful song.
I love Brown Skin Girl.
Yeah.
My personal favorite is Already Though.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. Well, it's tied between Already and Water. Because
Water is really good
too. But think about me, I want to play both of them at the same time.
Yeah, Water is a really good song too. One of the tracks that Beyonce is not featured on is Keys to the Kingdom. That kind of feels like I'm at like a parade, basically.
It's a good song. So I think with The Gift, granted, it was so funny that I bought both The Gift and The Lion King soundtrack at the same time.
Yeah.
Not knowing that Beyonce had made The Gift, I was like, okay, I must have made a mistake and bought a different one. So I bought both. And so then when I see Beyonce actually has more songs, I'm like, whoa. But then I see that it's not just a Beyonce album. I'm like, there's multiple artists. And I was like, okay. So I gave it a chance. So I left. But I was like, okay, this is an interesting story. Like, you can hear, like, you have an idea of where in the Lion King live action this song is supposed to fit. Yeah. And I think my favorite one is Ja'Adae. That shit feels so trippy to me. It just...
It do.
It's like... it's kind of like you walking into like almost like a cafe almost, and it's like late night, like blues playing, and it's like smoke thick, like you can smell the smoke, like the cigarette smoke or even the weed smoke.
Oh yeah.
And you're just like, everything just feels like it's happening in slow motion around you. It does it for me.
Yeah, that's another one that's pretty good. Keys of the Kingdom is pretty good. I think the most beautiful song on this project is Other Side. A lot of people say that Other Side is actually based off of her miscarriage. Then
I can see that.
Yeah. Other Side. I think production-wise, the best song is My Power. My Power gets you like hype. It's like going into battle, basically. A bunch of female warriors like going into battle.
It kind of feels like a sequel to Around the World.
Yeah. Like it feels like the Dora Milaje from Black Panther.
Yeah,
like this Black Panther, is their theme song, basically.
I feel like a lot of The Gift can also act as like a soundtrack to Black Panther. Not to shade the soundtrack Kendrick curated because it was beautiful, but
that was
beautiful. But I feel like The Gift can kind of do that, has that same purpose. And but granted, both The Lion King and Black Panther have a similar story.
Similar themes, yeah.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the last song that I actually really like is Scar with 070 Shake and Jesse Reyes.
It's different. It's different.
Very different. It gives me like Kanye West Yeezus vibes mixed with like, it kind of reminds me of this song from Fever Ray called Keep the Streets Empty For Me. If you haven't heard it, I actually recommend it. It's a pretty good song.
Okay.
But yeah. I mean, overall, The Gift is good. It's good. It's good. But it's like, it's not anything like, oh wow, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I put it in the same ranking as like the Black Panther soundtrack that Kendrick did. Great projects, but not ones that I would kind of go back to. Yeah, I'm kind of
okay. Now, before we continue though, like, because we gotta include the deluxe edition, that's when she included Black Parade and the extended edition of what song? I think it was
the extended edition of Black Parade too.
It was Black. You're right. So she put both on there, and any of the remixes and stuff like that. I feel like Black Parade fits on the album, but at the same time, I feel like it doesn't. It
feels like I said with Formation. It feels like the credits song.
Yes, basically. Thank you.
You know what I mean? It doesn't really fit. And Black Parade overall, I just think is okay. Like Black Parade, Be Alive, I think, okay, these are good songs, but it's like, I'm missing something. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like I'm missing that extra that makes Beyonce just
great. I got you. I don't think those songs are everyone's cup of tea. And that's okay. You know, at the end of the day, truthfully, every song, like I said, Forward's just not my cup of tea, but I'm not saying it's a bad song. You know, Black Parade and Be Alive, may just not be everybody's cup of tea, but also you have to think in the context Black Parade, I think, truly was just meant to be a single, and that she just felt the need to put it on the extended edition. I mean, on the deluxe, the extended edition on the deluxe version, because Black is King was coming out. And then you gotta remember, Be Alive was particularly for the King Richard film.
King Richard film, yeah. And originally, I thought Black Parade, I was like, okay, is this the single for the next album? Or, but it was a
see why. Yeah.
Song. It was a Juneteenth song that was put on.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so my overall score, while this isn't one of my favorite Beyonce projects, I don't think it's bad at all. I gave it the same score that I gave Dangerously in Love, like a 6.5 out of 10. While these songs aren't bad, they're good, I just think they kind of work in the context of the album, personally.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I also feel like Beyonce, there are moments where Beyonce doesn't really have that, like, it kind of feels like a lack of presence, even though she is still like, this is her project. She curated this whole project. Mm-hmm. It almost reminded me of when Kanye West released Donda. Like on the first half of Donda, Kanye didn't really have that sense of presence on his projects, but both are. But overall,
I would equate it more so to Kanye's when he did the Cruel Summer album, Good Music.
Yes,
I think it's more like that.
You hit it right out the ballpark.
I think when I rated The Gift, I would give it more so. I would give it an 8, truthfully. I think the artists that she included on there, I think she gave them a wider platform to listen on, because whether lover or hater, Beyonce kind of caters to every audience. And so I think you gave people like Jessie Reyez, WizKid, you know, people like that, gave them access to an audience they probably initially wouldn't have touched if they haven't already. So I think in that sense it's cool to think about, because it was kind of her like kind of laying the groundwork for other people to enter other realms, because in truth, an artist's longevity comes from expanding into different audiences, like Beyonce. Whether you like her or not, like I'm a heterosexual man, but Beyonce's target audience is typically the girls and the gays, you know, the LGBTQ plus community, not just specifically the gays. That's usually her target audience, but she's catered to the Afro community, especially with The Gift, because you know the Afrobeats. As we're gonna get to, as we're gonna get into Renaissance, you know, she caters more to the LGBTQ plus scene with Ballroom.
Yeah.
And then you know, pop and hip hop with Everything Is Love in her prior albums. So she's kind of in R&B. She's touching every audience so that you can get a glance into Beyonce. And if you like the album, great. If you didn't, hey, you still gave it a chance, and it was still a wonderful project. You're not taking it away from it.
Yeah, more power to you if you awesome. All righty. And now since we have went through her entire discography, let's talk about Act One of Renaissance. Now, I remember you texted me. You was like, Jordan, this is not a drill. And you sent me the post and you was like, get over there ASAP. And I was like, oh, it's about to go down. And I went over. First off, all the vinyls sold out. Yep. All that sold out, right? But it was a pre-save link for Spotify. And I was like, okay, let me hurry up and put my information there. Boom. Sent that out.
Wait. Look, as I casually have my Renaissance CD. Go and buy and stream, you know.
Yes. Literally, when I got there, sold out, right? And I was like, oh my God, Beyonce really about to come out with a new album. And then later that night, Drake, he surprise dropped, Honestly, Never Mind. I was like, oh, I'm like, what the hell is going on today, right?
Right.
And then listen to that. That was a really good listen. But Renaissance, I was ready. And then a few days before the album came out, it leaked. Like, I think somebody was selling it in France or something. And I was like,
so some of the stores in France had already got their packages of the CDs. So it was already available for purchase. So people had already bought them. Naturally so, because I probably would too if I was in that position. But I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna buy a damn Beyonce album. It's gonna be sold out the next day if I come back and it's not gonna be here. So
yes.
But I think also in the context they're thinking of, they're going to really, because you got to remember, Europe is like 6-7 hours ahead of us, depending on the country you're in. So for them, it was already time for Renaissance to be released. But I don't think they're thinking the contest they should be releasing when Beyonce says, when she says, I'm just giving it a random number. Let's say she says 10 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. You need to be releasing whatever that time is in Europe at that time.
Yeah. And listen, when I found out that this leak, it felt like I was a part of her team. I was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, what's going to happen? Like, I was I was seeing live streams of people reacting to the album. I was seeing, you know, reaction videos and all that. And I'm like, Beyonce basically gonna be like, oh no, I ain't doing a surprise drop.
I deleted my Twitter. I deleted my Twitter app and my I went on an Instagram cleanse because I just could not risk anyone spoiling it for me because I didn't want it to be spoiled for me.
And then there was this one review of some lady. She was like, Beyonce, and apparently she didn't like the project. She was like, Beyonce, I love you, but this ain't it. And I was like, whoa.
Yeah, that's honestly, a loaded phrase.
Honestly, that reaction, I was very interested going in. So, boom, when it came to midnight on July 29th, no question. I got up, I walked downstairs, I sat on my couch, I pulled up Spotify, and I pressed play. I'm going to just say this right now. The first 9 songs on this album are phenomenal. I'm That Girl pulled me in.
I think that is one of her rawest intros. It is her rawest intro. You literally start off with "these motherfuckers ain't stopping me," like,
I'm literally sitting on my couch at 12 o'clock in the morning, and I'm like, I'm not even asking no questions, press play. As soon as I heard that sample and as soon as I heard it speed up, I was like, okay,
yeah.
And then I heard these 808 start beating in this dark, deep southern voice just kicked in. And I was like, oh, here we go. And this album is an experience.
I think, especially on That Girl, I think what gets me hyped up is when she's like, I pull up in these clothes, look so good. Because I'm in that hoe. I was like, oh. And then she's like, you know, all these songs sound good. I was like, now she already talking shit about her own songs. She was like, because I'm on that hoe. I was like, and then she says, dead ass. I was like, whoa.
I'm listening to this and I'm like, okay. As it progressed, then transition, cozy, boom. Yeah, I should be asleep. I am up here dancing to this. Yeah. I'm dancing to all these songs.
Yeah. Cozy. God. Like when we talk about cozy, it literally feels like the name of the song, it feels so homey, but instead of double entendre, like she's saying she's comfortable, but she's also saying she's comfortable with being a Black person, and I think that's beautiful. She's also hyping this, well, not just hyping herself, she's like being like women and just people in general up, because she's she's a god, she's a hero, she survived everything she's been through. I think that's beautiful, like, because honestly, you don't know. Because like the whole thing she talked about Renaissance, which really I think just the whole all the acts, I should say, I think the whole thing is she talked about she made these in COVID. So, you know, I think when she talked about she survived everything she's been through, there's a lot of people that went through this pandemic who's lost someone or know someone that lost someone. You've done contracted COVID. You, God forbid, you ended up in the hospital, but a lot of people did. I think you're saying you survived everything. You went through that. You survived this. The potential losing your home. You know, a lot of people lost their homes, if not did lose their homes during this pandemic, and all those stimulus checks, they were cool on paper, but they didn't do too much. I'm not trying to get political.
Too much.
There's just so many underlying meanings where I think of cozy in those lyrics, and that just makes it beautiful. Yeah. Now, when we do that transition to Alien, Superstar Boy,
unpopular opinion, I think Alien Superstar should have been the lead single to this project.
You think
just just the opening of the guy saying, please do not.
No,
do
you not know. Oh, yeah.
The DJ booth is getting fixed or whatever. Like, imagine that you haven't heard Beyonce in 6 years and her comeback is a slow buildup. Her saying, I'm one of one. I'm the only one. Only one. Yeah. Don't even waste your time trying to compete
with me.
I almost screamed, period. Yeah. Oh my God.
Alien Superstar's intro is really good. Like,
oh my God.
I have chills thinking about it now, but like, it sends chills. Cause for real, cause when you think about it, who has longevity like Beyonce that's still alive today? A. And if you have that same longevity, are you pumping out albums that reach those chart topping numbers like her? Possibly not.
And are so good. Beyonce actually is getting better. Like, it's usually, you know, usually with an artist, okay, they start off at the top and then as time progresses, they kind of experience a decline. Beyonce is like, okay, start off at the top. She's in the stratosphere now.
Right. And when I say this, I'm not saying this to shade anybody. I think when it comes to Drake, I'm not shading, honestly, never mind. For me, the album as a whole just didn't do it too well for me. And I like to give all types of music a chance. But I think because Drake pushes something out every year, I think I'm just kind of tired of
I get that. Of
Drake projects. Not to say that I don't like them. It's just I just got tired. With Beyonce, she literally gives you years. We're seeing like, when is Tepa going to drop an album? You know? Like, you know, like I think it was right before self-titled. You know, he had that one guy in front of Parkwood's building like, where is the album? We need the damn album. That's literally how I felt waiting for Renaissance. And before she announced it.
Yeah, I mean, and I get that, you know, and a lot of people, you know, were like, oh, a lot of people say, you know, Drake tried to give House, sounded like Apartment. As somebody, unpopular opinion, I really dug, honestly, never mind. I feel like that album was the appetizer, it was the appetizer for Renaissance, basically.
I can see that. And for me, how I judge how good an album is, if I can at least say 55 to 60% of the album I like, then I think it's a good album. Mm-hmm. And I think it's just with Drake, it just didn't, it felt like, I think my godfather said it very best. Honestly, Nevermind feels like expensive, like store music. Like something you walk into like a Coach store or a Christian Louboutin store and you're going to hear. And that's fine. It's just, you know, everyone doesn't relate because that's not a place everyone, like, I want to hear Macy's music, you know, not to say that Beyonce's stuff is lower tier, but you're going to more than likely hear a Beyonce track in a Macy's.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I get you.
Now, when we talk about Renaissance, I think there was, you know, I think everyone obviously knows about the controversy about some of the songs, particularly Energy and Heated.
Yeah.
Now with Energy, I understood where Khalees was coming from. And I actually am a fan of Khalees. I think now, do I think Pharrell was right for what he did when it came to giving Beyonce the rights to use the song? No, because he didn't really have all that to do with it. However, Beyonce was legally in the right. She did everything legally right. I think she even tried to do more by adding Khalees' name as a songwriter because she didn't have to. Because Khalees was royalties off whatever Energy makes.
Exactly.
I'm not going to say I don't think anyone is stupid. I really don't. I just think in the heat of the moment, because Khalees was upset with what Pharrell did, I think in a sense she also kind of blocked a blessing at the same time.
Yeah. And in even Energy, I think that's one of my favorites too, Energy. I think, because when I first heard it, I was thinking to myself, this kind of reminds me of Milkshake to an extent, like Beam's intro. On stage, rocking on so crazy, Coco Friday night. That reminded me of my Milkshake brings out our boys to the
city. I see.
The cadence, all that. A lot of people just pointed out the follow la 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 ad libs, and I'm like,
because that's the only part of the song she used.
Yeah. Now, I think the cadence kind of reminds me of Milkshake, but overall, I mean, still great songs, personally.
But can we appreciate that transition between Cuff It, Energy, and Break My Soul? I didn't even know when I listened to the album, like, I didn't even realize we were in Energy until Beam started talking. I was like, Oh yeah.
And even Break My Soul, originally a song that I was like, okay, that's cool.
It's cute. It sounds even better in Renaissance.
Yeah, and I told my aunt this. Well, my aunt told me this. Break My Soul is cool, but in the context of the album, it's really good. It's good.
Absolutely. I love the transition because, like, you know, you hear at the end of Energy, you hear the yeah from, you know, Big Frida into Break My Soul. So it's like, you know, Break My Soul is about to come on. And it's like, okay, this is cool. Now, I remember talking with my friends about this. I knew she was about to get nasty with Church Girl. I just knew it. I felt it in my spirit.
That was another. that was another song that grew on me, Church Girl. And Church Girl, it feels like, you know, it feels like you're at a family reunion and you and all your cousins and all them, y'all just go out and y'all just do some reckless shit, bro.
Yeah.
Oh man,
that's absolutely that's a good one. Another song that I really like, okay, I'm just going to put it out there. For me, my favorite songs on Renaissance, they change every 2-3 days. Like, I never have like a direct, like, these are my 5 or 4 or whatever. And that's they literally change every day. So currently, Heated has been keeping that number one spot because at the end, that ending. Listen, God. I bro. There sometime I listen to the whole song, but sometimes I just want to hear that part, so I'll skip to the end of that.
I'm telling you now,
I understand what people are saying when it comes to the controversy of using that word. However, there are a lot of words that have different meanings that are, and some of those meanings are offensive. When used in African American vernacular, that word has a different meaning. It just means go crazy, you know, just, you know, go ham or whatever you're doing. I don't think it's fair that Beyonce nor Lizzo should have had to change their lyrics, because there are a lot of artists out here who've done similar things with different words.
Oh yeah, like I'm gonna use Kendrick Lamar, for example, on Miss Morale, the song Auntie Diaries.
He got a lot of flack for that
one. The F slur, and I'm not gonna lie, that actually took me out the project. I mean, and this is coming from a heterosexual man, like a straight man. Mm-hmm. I hate that word. I'm just like, nah. I'm not, But yeah, I mean,
I think we just have to look at it from the sense of the context of the song.
Yeah.
Now if she was calling someone that word within, like she was visiting this community, or these so-and-so is acting like a so-and-so, then that's different. Then that's when that's not okay. But she just, it's literally call and response. That's literally what they do in the ballroom scene. It's a thing. And I love it because there was the first in Heated when she's like, Monday, I'm overrated, Tuesday, on my dick. I was like,
I'm like, yes, that's how people are. Like, bro, I'm telling you, the one thing though, I just wish Drake was featured on this, because that would have been, oh my God. But overall, I just think Heated was, I was like, yes.
It's a great song. I enjoy it.
Aubrey put your foot in that.
Even with the redaction, where she changed it to Blast, I don't think it takes away from it. But I think because the thing is, when I pre-ordered Renaissance, I got the original version and I had it for a hot minute, but then it changed. Like, she changed even in my purchase. I was like, that's crazy. But also at the same time, everyone that bought those poses with like these shirts with different type of poses, all of them came with the Renaissance CD. So if you bought a pose, you have the original version on CD.
Yeah.
Which is cool to think about. Because I mean, like I said, I have no shade to any community. I am an inclusive person. I just think that the anger towards that word and how it was used was just misdirected. I'll say it like that.
Yeah. I think it was. Now, Church Girl, that's a great song. Plastic Off the Sofa feels not only dangerously in love inspired.
Yes.
It also feels like, I'm surprised Solange wasn't featured on this.
It also feels like, I think that's, I've heard Amorphis mix them, but I think it's a good, if you haven't listened, it's pretty good. He does a mashup of Plastic Off the Sofa with Cranes in the Sky.
That's what it reminded me of.
It feels very natural.
Yeah. Plastic Off the Sofa definitely reminds me of Cranes in the Sky. But can we talk about Virgo's Groove?
It's a good song.
Oh, you know what it reminded me of when I was listening to it coming back? I was like, this kind of reminds me of if Spotlight by Jennifer Hudson, Million Dollar Bill by Whitney Houston, and Daft Punk had a baby.
I could see that. It would be
this song right here.
Yeah, no, because Virgo's Groove feels very fun. And feels like she's just jamming, you know, like it feels like she was just casually talking in the studio and just happened to record button was on, know. So, and I love her. It feels very campy, and I think a lot of people appreciate that. Now, Move, I like Move a lot. I do.
Move grew on me too. Move is another song. Originally, I was like, okay, Move is cool. I listened to it today, and I heard Grace Jones, Baka.
Yeah.
Something in the jungle. And I'm like, yeah. Right.
But what's funny is, because Grace Jones is like Sade. Her ass just stays hidden for a long time and then popped up out of nowhere. So to see Grace Jones pop up and Beyonce giving her tens, but you know, yes. But shout out to both of them because they're both amazing artists and they're in their own right. I like when Beyonce, like, if you listen closely in the background, she's like, every time Grace Jones talks, you hear Beyonce and Grace Jones. It just feels like Jones. Like you can tell she really was excited to have both Thames and Grace Jones on the track, yeah. Which is cool.
And I think the second half of Move is even better. And Beyonce's contributions, it was like, I can't remember the lyrics, but it was like the dun 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 dun.
Yeah.
Dun, dun, dun,
me dun. And my girlfriends came up to play Broken Glass on you, man. Yeah.
Like I could just imagine in a music video, I can imagine her with Tim's and Grace Jones, and they just about to go into this club and fuck shit up.
When I think about the second half of Move, it kind of reminds me a little bit of Blow.
Yeah.
Especially when she does the on your face. I was like, oh. That's
yeah.
But it's fun. It we talked about Heated, but Thick is dangerous.
Something about the and fun fact about Thick, Hit Boy actually made that in 2014. So we're talking about post self-titled era.
Interesting.
And now that I think about it, I can kind of hear Thick on self-titled, kinda.
I mean, which makes sense because when you think about it. Artist, like, you know, those 10-15 tracks you see on the album, the artist didn't record just those 10-15 tracks. They probably recorded a good 30 and they had to narrow it down which ones they wanted off the album.
Yeah, I had to narrow it down. And a part of Thick kind of reminds me of Bad Guy by Billie Eilish.
I can see that.
The
yep. And it kind of sounds like it's slowed down a little bit. Yeah, I see it. Yeah.
And then okay, we have 10 minutes left, but we're almost done.
Right.
So let's just keep going. Two songs, originally I was like, I don't know about this, but they actually grew on me. All Up in Your Mind and America Has a Problem.
Yeah, it did for me too.
I think All Up in Your Mind, very Fever Ray inspired. It kind of reminds me of Arca a little bit, if you've ever listened to Arca. And this is a weird analogy, but it kind of feels like I'm in an arcade in like Gotham City. Here's why. Okay, you've seen the Batman, right?
Yeah.
You've seen the Batman. Imagine, do you remember the Iceberg Lounge scene where Batman goes in and beats? Imagine this song playing during that scene.
Okay, with that context, I see what you mean. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Originally, it took me a minute because I'm like, this is really experimental and I'm not sure about this. And then we get America Has a Problem. Now, when I first heard the title, Mortal Kombat. Yep. Now, when I first heard America Has a Problem, the title, I was like, okay, this is probably going to be like, she probably is going to talk about the Breonna Taylor situation. She's probably going to talk about all that. Mm-hmm. And I'm listening to it. I'm like, what's up? Now, I basically got the idea that she is using the problem was drug addiction, that she views sex like a drug, basically.
Okay.
Now, another idea that I got for a music video, if Beyonce came to us and said, Jordan and Sean, I am making this visual album, what would y'all do for America Has a Problem? First of all, you would have to reassemble me after I blew up in a million pieces. But this is what I would have done. Sean, have you ever seen the Marvel film Blade?
Of course I have. With Wesley Snipes. Okay. Yeah.
With Wesley Snipes. Do you remember the opening scene of Blade where it's this giant rave and then all these vampires are there and blood starts?
Okay.
Okay. Imagine that, right? There's this guy who is, you know, going to this party. He sees all of these crazy people. They're having fun and they're attacking him and all that. He's crawling to get out. And then you see this stiletto heel, right? It pans up and you see Beyonce in this long black trench coat, shades, fishnets, thigh high boots, and she has a samurai sword.
Okay.
That will be my America Has a Problem.
I think the way I would have done America has a problem with, because you know I told you I just said sounds like Mortal Kombat. I think how I would start is like cut it to like an old school arcade. You're probably on the little joystick type fighting games, right? Yeah. And the title of the of the game is America has a problem. And it zooms into the screen, like you see the thankful and Beyonce. I'm thinking Beyonce dressed up as like Katana from Mortal Kombat, right? Oh, and she's in the little fighting stance. And then the song starts, and then like it like changes from like the little pixelated look to like, you know, the real bodies, and they're doing dance moves in the Mortal Kombat background. And yeah, that's as far where I'd go with it. Cause and then the underlying theme is America has a problem is what is Mortal Kombat? It's a fighting game. Violence is our problem. Yeah.
Beyonce, can you hire us for your next official album, please? Nah. Oh
god. But now Pure Honey. If I'm that girl, it's not the start, like the intro to her next concert, it's gonna be Pure Honey. I'm willing to bet money on that.
Oh yeah. Pure Honey, that's good. And then Beyonce is really good at capping the album off. Summer Renaissance, that's a beautiful
ending.
It's a beautiful send-off to not only the album, but to summer. Like that's a perfect end of summer type of song. And then when Beyonce says round of applause, I literally was like, was clapping. Like,
but like I think we also should give Beyonce her 10th on that song because she gives the tribute to Donna Summer. Because it's very much a Donna Summer song. That she's using. Yeah. But I think my favorite verse, especially of a Summer Renaissance, is that part where she's like, I want your touch, I want your feeling. And then it's the call back, and it's like, I want your love, I want your spirit. The more I want, the more I need it. And then she just sings that last part. I was like, I want to cry.
I was like, at the end of that project, I literally clapped. I was like, a perfect album. So perfect.
And but you know, we had a lot of girls in. Not well. Actually, the people in like a little heated about the song because she's like, this Telfar back imported these Birkins. This shit's in storage. People are like, why are you talking about that song? So I'm like, she's just trying to give light to more black businesses as she's always done. Relax. She didn't say she threw them away. She said they're in storage. She didn't throw them away.
Oh yeah. And I like that she said Birkins plural. She got many of those.
She got many. I think it's also funny how she talked about Telfar because, you know, Telfar saw a really big increase when Beyonce was first posted up with a picture with a Telfar bag. So I think, not to say that Telfar wouldn't have been successful without Beyonce's free promo, but Beyonce definitely helped them get an extra set of fans because personally, all my girlfriends who talked about they want a Telfar bag, they can never get it because it's always sold. Telfar always has a sold out thing on their page. Yeah. You can never get a Telfar. Beyonce is a trendsetter in herself.
Oh yeah,
and she proved that she's only ever competing with herself.
She is. That's the only person who Beyonce is competing with herself, bro. That's why I hate when people be making these comparisons. It's like, yo, none of bro.
But I think
that's a discussion for a whole nother podcast, bro.
We're in a society where the industry pumps out so many of artists with commonalities. Like, you know, they're trying to build the next Nicki, the next Lil' Kim, even the next Beyonce. I think artists need to just have fun. They need to just realize that they're only in a race with themselves. Only time I can see where you're trying to compare people is like when you're at awards show, obviously, because only one person can win the title. But it's like, just be in a race with yourself and make art like Beyonce is doing, because that's what she's focused on. That's why you don't see her popping out an album every single year. No tea, no shade to any artist.
Yeah,
but she even talked more about it. She was like, you know, people don't make records anymore. They're too busy trying to pump out another hit, and they're going to get burnt out. So,
Overall, I mean, I was really conflicted. I was like, okay, where does this rank in my Beyonce albums? I'm like, okay, is this my favorite? Still, if self-titled still my favorite, I'm gonna give this album 9.5 out of 10. Same thing as self-titled. I think it was a euphoric and cathartic experience. And like I mentioned, unlike other artists who experience a decline in their careers, Beyonce just keeps getting better.
She's so big. She's so big. Folks are every outlet is talking about it's her birthday today. Like,
right? It's her birthday.
It's a birthday. Ooh.
Right. And remember, this is act one of Renaissance.
So we still got I can't wait to see the other two, three. Right.
I can't wait to see these visuals, bro, to be honest.
Ciao. I'm waiting for them. I'm trying to be patient, but it's like at the same time. And she's giving us teasers. Like, she gave us the I'm That Girl teaser. And yes. I feel like she gave us a teaser of all the visuals, because like all those various different versions we saw, different looks of Beyonce. I think those are for other things. But then with her Tiffany & Co. Promo, she was Summer Renaissance. So I'm like, was that the Summer Renaissance video you just showed us?
Yeah, I'm like, what is it? A part of me actually thought she was going to release the visuals today on her birthday, but I was like, you know what?
I think too many people expect that.
Yeah, I was like, you know what? That's doing too much. Just digest Renaissance. Yeah. And one day, maybe either on Christmas or whatever, this is my gift to y'all, the visual.
Because that'd be a very bold move if she didn't release any visuals, considering she's given us at least one visual for every project she's been on. So it'd be very different for her not to give us. Now, I think if she didn't give us the visuals now, I felt like she would wait till all three acts are out and then just give us all. Plethora of
that would be like one lump sum movie. Oh, that would be great. That actually kind of makes sense. Yeah. Oh man. Beyonce. First off, happy birthday. But
oh yes, happy birthday. Happy 41st.
Oh heck yeah.
Here's the 41 more.
Yeah, more life, long life, and that's it. Sean. Thank you so much for embarking on this journey as we did a retrospective on this amazing, amazing human being. It's incredible.
Thank you for having me, man. It was a fun ride. I love talking about Beyonce. She is my favorite artist, and I will always rep her to the day I die.
Always rep. Always rep. And thank you guys for watching 1025 In Conversation. I'm Jordan, along with Sean, and we will see you next time.